Hey everybody, I'm Harris O'Malley from DrNerdLove.com. Now, last time we talked about how to be a more interesting person. Today, I want to take that to the next level by helping you with a undervalued, underutilized skill, how to tell amazing stories. Now, when I say telling stories, I don't mean reading to the kids at bedtime or crafting a compelling narrative for your D&D campaign. I'm talking about how you convey the information about your life. See, most of us don't think about how we present ourselves to others. Not the way that we look or the way we act, but why people should want to get to know us and want to spend time with us. Telling a story about yourself is part of how you convey who you are. And it can be a great way to show off without really seeming like it, just a little bit. When you're at an interview and they're asking you about a time that you overcame a challenge, you're telling a story. When your date wants to know more about where you grew up or what you did or what makes you you, you're telling a story. When you're pitching your ideas or your services to another person, you're telling a story. And the best, most interesting people know how to convey that information in a compelling, entertaining manner that keeps the listener actively engaged. Now, one of the common mistakes that people make when they think about telling an interesting story is they think that the subject is all that matters, or they think that if it's not the most unique exotic adventure, then it can't possibly make an interesting story. Not true. On the one hand, if you know how to tell a story the right way, you can make even the most mundane events fascinating. On the other hand, you can take the most incredible story and suck the life out of it if you don't know how to tell it properly. For example, after I graduated from high school, my family and I got a chance to take a photo safari in Tanzania, and it was really cool. I really enjoyed it. I got a lot out of it, but I think my favorite part was probably the elephant. I think the elephant charging us was probably the best part. This is all true, by the way, but as out of the ordinary as that might be, the way that I'm telling it makes it kind of dull. The subject matter is interesting, but there's not a lot to grab onto there. The way that it's being told is dry, it's flat. This is the antithesis of a good story. If you want to tell stories that have your listeners riveted, then you have to understand how to structure it and how to tell it properly. And that means starting from the end. A good story is like a dagger. It's short and has a point. Wait. Everyone's familiar with that person who tells stories that just meander onwards and it just keeps going and going and going. You don't want to do this. When you tell a story, you want to know exactly where it's going and why you're telling it. What is the reaction that you want people to have when you finish your story? When you're telling a story about, say, something that happened to you at a bar, then you want to think about what you want your audience to react to. Are you trying to tell them about something cool that you did and you're trying to impress them? Or are you trying to talk about something funny that happened and you want to laugh? Or are you trying to tell something heartwarming and give them a case of the warm fuzzies? The more you understand what the point of the story is and why you're sharing it, the better of a story it'll be. You're not just telling a story, you're taking your listeners on an emotional journey with you. You're not just sharing information, you're sharing emotion. And that creates a sort of bond between the two of you. And generally speaking, a good story usually ends either in a cool, a aww, or a laugh. Obviously, there will be other ways that you may want a story to end and other reactions that you'll want to get, but these are the most common reactions you're going to want from any particular social setting you're going to find yourself in. Next, consider who you're telling the story to. Your audience absolutely changes the way that you tell your story. One of the mistakes that people make when they're telling a story about something they're really excited about is that they get a little too inside baseball. We use jargon that they may not be familiar with, or talk about concepts that they may not understand. The more that you have to stop and explain things, the more you're interrupting the flow of your story. If you've ever seen someone trying to explain the plot of, say, Naruto to Muggles, then you know exactly what I'm talking about. When you're telling a story, you don't want to have to stop to clarify things. Every non-intentional pause you take bleeds away your audience's interest. So, you want to keep things as simple and as accessible as possible so that the story can flow. You Also want to keep things concise. Not everybody is going to want to hear your 15-minute dance remix version of the time you and your buddies crashed a bachelorette party and then you ended up doing shooters all night with the bridesmaids at Carlos and Charlie's. Once you understand the point of your story, it's time to structure it. And you start with the transition. The transition is very simply how you get everybody's attention on you instead of just diving right in and hoping everybody realizes that you're talking now. You might start with a phrasal transition, saying something like, "Oh, hey, that reminds me," or, "Yeah, check this out." Or you might use an observational transition, where you use something around you, something that somebody said, something somebody did, and use that as the springboard into telling your story, like a triggering a flashback on Arrow. "Yeah, that reminds me about the time when..." Next, you set the hook. The part of your story that is going to capture your listener's curiosity. This is the part that makes people want to listen. A good hook is a question that needs an answer. It's like Alfred Hitchcock's theory of storytelling. Show a bomb going off and you'll surprise people for a second. Tell people that a bomb will go off in 5 minutes, and now everybody's engaged because there are unanswered questions. What is the bomb doing there? Who put it there? Are the heroes going to get out in time? These unanswered questions keep your audience riveted. So, you want to set the hook by hinting at the climax of the story with an unanswered question. For example, true story, by the way, did I ever tell you about the time that I nearly got shot by a clown? There are a host of unanswered questions there. What was I doing with the clown around? Why did the clown have a gun? Why was the clown pointing a gun at me? Or, going back to my previous story, "Yeah, it's just not an O'Malley vacation unless something tries to kill us. Last time I went on vacation, I was nearly murdered by a rampaging elephant." Next, you need characters. Characters bring your story to life. They give them texture and interest. It's one thing to tell the story about how you nearly got into a bar fight with a guy who thought you were hitting on his date. It's a decent story, but the characters are flat. There's no depth, there's no meat. Now, if that guy who you nearly got into a fight with is a small-time street hustler who is trying to impress his date with stories about how he's going to be cornering the legal weed market in Colorado because he's got a startup with a new experimental strain of weed that he's being backed by an unnamed yet very popular and famous pothead celebrity, now you've got a better image of what this guy's like. You can practically see him there telling these stories to his increasingly bored date who has heard them all and is obviously only there for the free drinks. Having characters makes the story more vivid. They capture the listener's imagination and make everything more arresting. They don't need to be crazy over the top. They just need to be distinct and unique. And you can really make them come to life with very broad brushstrokes and very simple techniques. Adjust your posture and the way that you sit or you stand for each character. Maybe some are very confident, so they are very upright. Maybe some are very shy or very sneaky, so you kind of fold in on yourself. Give each character their own unique voice. "Well, we don't get many people like you around here." And while you're at it, consider the language that you use while you're telling a story. Telling a story is about more than just A, then B, then C. You want to use evocative, descriptive language to paint a picture with words, if you will. You're taking people on a journey with you, and you want them to feel it the way that you felt it. So it's not just this happened, and then this happened, and then this happened. You want them to be there with you. So, if it happened at night, what kind of night was it? Was it cold? Was it hot? Was it humid? How did you feel? Were you confident? Were you uncomfortable? Why? What were you thinking? What were you feeling? The more that you can create that sense of, "No shit, there I was," the more compelling and engaging your stories will be because they will draw your listeners in. They'll be able to engage with it on a more visceral level because they're right there with you. So, now you have your goal, your hook, your characters, and your language. You need to weave it all together. And to give you an idea of what that might look like, let me tell you the story about the time that I was nearly killed by a rampaging elephant. So, I had just graduated from high school, and my mom, my brother, and I had this once-in-a-lifetime exciting opportunity to go on a photo safari in Tanzania by basically beta testing a family friend's new travel agency. So, it's me, my mom, my brother, my mom's best friend, and her daughter all traveling across the Serengeti, going from lodge to lodge in this rickety Volkswagen bus. And it was summer here, so it was fall there, and we are there in time for the Great Migration, when all of the herd animals, the wildebeest, the zebra, the antelope, everything is traveling north for the winter. And it's around Lobo that we catch up with the elephant migration. So, there we are, going up this really steep hill in this rickety Volkswagen bus, when all of a sudden, a large herd of elephants starts crossing the road. And because there is no way to hurry up an elephant when it doesn't want to, our guide, Cornelius, has to put the car into park, turn off the engine, and now we have to sit there and wait. Now, the thing that I didn't know is that elephants in the wild, when they don't like you, have a dominance display. And what they do is they shake out their ears, and they trumpet, and then they charge forward 3 steps. No one told me they did this. So the first time an elephant took exception to our presence, and trumpeted and charged, I screamed like a little girl. And I did it again the second time. And the third. Much to the amusement of my family. So, now I'm kind of used to it, or at least as used to it as you can be, when a dinosaur-sized animal is pissed off at you. I am sitting there trying to hold myself together as these giant elephants are crossing the road. And every once in a while, one turns and shakes out their head and trumpets at us, and I kind of go, eek, and keep my cool. And then, eventually, everything is going great, until Great Grandmama starts to cross the road, and then she decides that she is not pleased with us being here, because there are little baby elephants in the herd, and she feels that we might be a threat. So she stops, she turns, shakes out her ears, trumpets, and charges. And I am sitting in the back of the rickety Volkswagen bus saying, okay, this is gonna be fine, this is gonna be fine. 3 steps, 3 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, oh my god, we're gonna die! Cornelius, our guide, realizing what's going on, starts to try to turn the engine back on, and he floods it. So now all he's doing is just grinding the gears, and apparently an elephant, this translates as, come have a go if you think you're hard enough. So Great Grandmama thinks that we are challenging her back, drops her head, and now she's coming at us hell-bent for leather. I'm screaming, the elephant is charging, our guide throws the car into neutral, and we are now just sliding backwards down this hill with a goddamn giant elephant chasing after us. We are going backwards down this hill, 30 miles an hour. We do not know what the hell is behind us. We are just hoping that we don't die. We get to the bottom of the hill, we come to a screeching halt as Great Grandmama stops, decides we've had enough, turns around, walks away, stops, looks back over her shoulder like, oh yeah, you'd better run, and then stalks off. We all take a deep breath. I look at my mom's best friend, and she looks at me, and she says, damn it, Harris, I couldn't hear the elephant over you. So, another thing to keep in mind, every story has its own pace and its own rhythm. It's a little like music that way. And it takes time and practice to really feel out what each story needs. So as you're coming up with your stories, don't just write them down or don't just have them in your head. You want to practice them. So recite them into the webcam of your laptop, say them to the mirror, speak them into the audio memo function of your smartphone, play them back, listen to how it sounds, and just fine-tune and edit it until it feels right. It'll take a little time and repetition to get it right. And one more thing. I always tell people that in an ideal world, they want to have 3 stories locked, cocked, and ready to go. This just means that you have a story ready to pull out of your pocket at any time you might need one, instead of trying to compose something right there on the spot. Don't worry about whether something is dramatic enough or exciting enough to be a good story. Just focus on the emotions and the structure. Once you understand how to tell a story properly, you can make even the everyday absolutely fascinating. Hey! Thanks for checking out my video. You've heard a couple of my stories, so tell me a little bit about yours. Share some of the stories that you're developing in the comments below. If you've got a short dating question or a topic you'd like to hear more about on here, hit me up, either share it in the comments or send it to me at doc@drnerdlove.com and put "for YouTube" in the subject heading. Meanwhile, if you want more dating advice, check out my books. I've written them, you want to read them, links to buy them in the show notes below. And if you do check them out, then do me a huge favor and leave a review on Amazon and Goodreads. It's a huge help. If you enjoyed the video, let me know. Hit that thumbs up button. If you've really been digging the series, if you've been feeling like it's really helping you and you're getting a lot out of it and you want to support the channel, then consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/drnerdlove. Even $1 a month is a huge help to keep things going. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter at Dr. Nerdlove. Join the Facebook page at facebook.com/drnerdlove. And as always, smash that logo in order to subscribe. Check out my other videos, and I will be back with you next week with more tips about love, sex, and dating. Later.